Good morning, everyone. We have already formed a quorum. We have three items on the agenda today. And we have three information papers under another item. And it's an update or forecast of proposed creation of deletion of directorate posts in the 2013 and 14 legislative session, and also update on overall directorate establishment position. So that was proposed by Ms. Emily Lau last time. So just a reminder for members, if there is any direct or indirect pecuniary interests involving the proposals today, then under Rule 83A of the rules of procedure, members are required to declare such interests before they speak. I'd also like to draw members' attention to Rule 84 with regard to the voting procedures where there is any direct pecuniary interests. Item 1, Information Papers, ECI 2013-14, 6, 8, and 9. So altogether three information papers. Earlier on, the administration submitted the paper ECI 2013-14-6 setting out the proposed directorate grade post to be created within this year, and Ms. Emily Lau would like to discuss it. On top of that, the administration has also provided supplementary papers under ECI number 8 and ECI number 9. And ECI number 9 set out the changes on the situation with regard to directorate establishment and also the impact of today's three proposals on the establishment of the directorate post. And under the current arrangements with regard to any proposal submitted by the administration to the ESC, they will consult the relevant panel on the proposals first. With us today, she is still on her way, and we have Selena here. So we have Ms. Selena Yan here, and also Mr. Mac, who is here. So there is no need for us to approve this paper. All right, Ms. Yip Kin Yun would like to speak. Who else? Ms. Emily Lau, Mr. Sin Chong Kai. 5 minutes each. Mr. Yip. Madam Chair, concerning the update on the overall directorate establishment position, I've read the paper, and apparently with regard to the number of supernumerary posts, there has been a steady increase in the size of supernumerary posts, including the extension of such posts that has been growing. So you can see from the figures, the number has increased from 7 in 2011 to 12 in 2012. And for the extension, there has been very lengthy extension. So I'm not going to go into the details. I'd just like to know whether or not the trend will continue, and why do we have this situation? Why do they have to create supernumerary posts in the first place? So can we be given more explanation so that we can have a better understanding of the trend? Would like to speak, Mr. Mac? Yes. In considering whether or not we should create a permanent post or a supernumerary post, mainly the consideration is whether or not the post is time-limited or is needed permanently, or whether it's, or even if it's a permanent requirement, whether or not the mode of operation could be reviewed after creating it for a while. That's why it's a cautious approach by creating the post as a supernumerary posts in the first place. So there is a series of considerations as regards the actual figures. If I may draw members' attention to paper number 9, when we compare 2012 and 2013, if you look at the number of supernumerary posts, actually there has been a cut. If you look at the table, in fact, in January 2012, the figure back then was 60, and as at the 3rd of December 2013, it's only 50. That's why the number has come down. And as members might be aware, when it comes to supernumerary posts, when they expire, when the time approved by the FC expires, then the post will be deleted automatically, and then the Bureau will consider whether or not there is a need for the post to be kept, and if they have to be turned permanent, then they would have to come back again for scrutiny by members. Madam Chair, all right, we've been told that this is a cautious approach, but then we are concerned that by making them supernumerary, which could be deleted later, all right, we can also be less cautious when we approve such creations. Just now, we've been given the figure, and that's 2002 and now, but then in recent years, the trend has been that the growth is rather rapid. And then for the situations where such posts have to be extended, in fact, it's also rising. 2 years ago, we only had two. So every year, you come back asking for an extension. Now, instead of having two, we now have 13. So combining all these factors, I think we do have a duty to look at whether or not this is an overall trend. And is there a trend that the administration is trying to take an alternative approach to create these posts through the back door? Mr. Mack, with regard to the creation of supernumerary posts and also the request for extension, the application and also the scrutiny procedure would be the same. In other words, internally, we will have to scrutinize whether or not there is justification for that, and then we'll have to come back to the relevant panel of this council before we come to the ESC, and then we will have to go to the FC. So the mechanism is as stringent as when we ask for the creation of permanent posts. As regards why we have to create a supernumerary post in the first place, that's because of the nature of the job, whether or not it's time limited, and then by a certain time we will have to review whether or not we have to extend it, or are there particular reasons why instead of creating it for a particular while, because of the mode of operation, we believe that there is some room for review, and after 2 or 3 years, and then we'll look at how it should continue, and then when necessary, we'll have to extend it. But then, as I said just now, even if it's to be extended or if we have to create a new post, we will definitely have to come back to the ESC and also the FC for approval. Ms. Emily Lau, Madam Chair, I share the concerns of Mr. Yip Kin Yun. That is, they are asking for the creation of many posts in 2013 and 14. For permanent posts, we have 10. And then for supernumerary, we have 19, altogether 29. And then for extension, 13 will be extended. So these are supernumerary posts, and together they add up to a rather sizable figure. And of course, you said that the workload has been increasing. Yes, we can understand that. But then I don't think this is a very good approach, because many people might have this impression, because they are not happy with the performance of many departments. And also, on top of that, some frontline civil servants are also facing a lot of pressure. With regard to the supervisors, they are also not happy with the supervisors either. So with the increase of these posts, will that help? Because according to some civil servants, they are actually greasing the top while skimming the bottom. So how are you going to deal with the situation? And there are two posts which I'd like to specifically highlight. On page 9, they are referring to the housing department, and you have to create 3 permanent posts. They are architects and also engineers and so on. And apparently it's for them to roll out the construction or the housing production program. Yes, the DP is in favor of that, because we would like to identify more land, because we have more than 200,000 people waiting for allocation. But then according to our understanding from the Housing Department, they do have difficulties when they go to the district. And of course, they will have to liaise with the residents and also the district councillors. And sometimes it will take them 20, 30 times of discussion. And why do you have to create more engineer posts? Because they are not supposed to do such negotiations because they are technical or technocrats. So how are you able to ensure that there will be manpower to deal with such difficult problems? Because it doesn't seem that you're able to tackle those problems, because when it comes to actual work, they are also having a very difficult time if every time they will have to go to 20, 30 meetings before they can resolve a problem. Then, of course, we cannot understand how hard-pressed they are. Another issue is private clubs. So it's on page, it's in Annex 2. So a directorate, a directorate post has to be created and supposed to look at the land lease involving such a private recreational lease. So I think it's already too late. So you're actually crying foul after something has happened long ago. All right, you've been granting leases or land to them at such low premium. So are you able to respond to the aspiration or demand by this council? Thank you. Well, on the creation of posts, whether or not it's permanent or supernumerary, or whether it's a directorate or non-directorate post, we have to adhere to two principles. Number one, we have to manage our finances in a prudent manner in order to control or contain the size of the civil service. And the second point has been referred to by Ms. Emily Lau. We can see that there is a lot of new workload or new jobs, and then we will have to look at the arrangement of our establishment in order to see if we need to appropriately increase our manpower in order to meet the demand of our work. So it depends on the circumstances. And of course, we will be looking at the situation, and there is a set of very stringent procedures for us to consider. And after the relevant Department or Bureau has made the suggestion, we also have to look at whether or not we can justify that, and whether it's the Civil Service Bureau or the FSTB, we will also be scrutinizing the applications. And then we will have to make sure that, number one, there have to be sufficient justifications for supporting the creation of the post. And secondly, with regard to the additional workload, it cannot be absorbed through other alternative means before we will support that. So whether it's a permanent or supernumerary post or directorate or non-directorate post, we have adopted the same principles or approach.
And that is why we always adopt a very prudent approach. Regarding the types of grades, whether it's a technical grade or other non-technical grades, and which would be the better option. Of course, it would depend on the workload which the frontline staff of the department concerned will submit the relevant proposals, and then our resource departments will approve them accordingly. Of course, we also need to go to the various panels in electrical for approval. There is a very stringent mechanism to deal with each item. Regarding the two departments referred to by Ms. Emily Lau, that is the Housing Department and the Home Affairs Bureau, I'd like to leave it to the relevant departments and bureaus to respond when they submit the proposals to the relevant panels for discussion. Mrs. Sin Chung Kai, according to the document, the number of civil servants in 2001, we have 1,374 directorate posts, and it slightly dropped to 1,336. Basically because we have an increase in number of judicial officers, because there's a need to reduce the backlog. So the overall, you have some made some achievements regarding the overall size of the establishment. But since 2007, when you introduced the accountability system, the three secretaries and the 14 secretaries. I mean, previously those heads of bureaus are not included into the establishment. So I think you should at least give us an annex. To include the number of politically accountable officers. They are not civil servants, but they are still senior officers. And for the general public, they actually are the highest echelon of the civil service. So in theory, I think we should also have an understanding of that category of senior officers. If one talks about the headcount and if we include the number of accountable officers, I believe the growth has been quite significant. I think we're talking about at least 10%. If you include the deputy secretaries and the political assistants, we're talking about several dozens. Yeah. So I think the CSB should also tell us in the paper to give us a whole picture. That is, on top of the 160,000 civil servants, how many senior officers are there? We should not be just be looking at the top of the civil service structure, but also the head of the government hierarchy altogether. Madam Chair, to answer Mr. Sin's question regarding the figures, I think one can see that previously we've actually put in a lot of effort to contain the size of the civil service establishment, and there is a slight decline in the numbers compared with 2002. And Mr. Sin said recently we've created some more posts. Even if we do not include the number of politically accountable officers, if one looks at the civil service systems, whether it's the directed or non-directed post, there has been some growth in the numbers. But over the past few years, the growth has been less than 1%. And this shows that the workload of civil servants has gone up, and having considered the work requirements, we need to increase the number of staff accordingly. Regarding the figures referred to in the paper, I think the figures tell us about the size of the overall civil service establishment. This is to facilitate the discussion by the ESC, and that's why we've provided figures for civil servants, ICAC officers, and judicial officers and judges. I understand, but people who read the documents would like to know that at the upper echelon of government, including the politically accountable officers, we need to have an overall number. Apparently, the number has gone down, but previously, in 2007, the policy secretaries were civil servants, but after 2007, they have become politically accountable officers. So I think in theory, the size of the civil service establishment should be even smaller, but the decline in number is smaller. So I think you have 14 secretaries and heads of bureaus, and you have all the deputy secretaries and assistants. We're talking about 40 people together. If you also include the senior government officers, the overall size has gone up, actually. There has been quite a substantial increase in numbers. Any further supplement? Madam Chair, let me supplement on Mr. Mack's point. Why is it that we've not included those figures in this document? Because this is the ESC under the Finance Committee, and the proposals for supported by the ESC will go to the FC. I think even for politically accountable officers, you have still to go to the FC. Well, the proposed addition and deletion to directorate posts by the ESC, eventually they will be incorporated in the budget of the respective departments. And that's why when we submitted the documents, we are subject to the constraint that the ESC will, going forward will scrutinize each and every of these posts. Whereas for the posts of politically accountable officers, they are not within the remit of the ESC. But if members would like some supplementary information, we can certainly provide them in a different format. Let me reiterate again that this document, the intention of the document is to tell us the number of people at the upper echelon of government, but then if you do not give us the figures of the politically accountable officers, then you're not showing us the full picture. Dr. Kwok Kar Kai. I hope the government will understand that the purpose of showing us these figures is to show us that we're getting value of money. In fact, the policy, the heads of bureaus and deputy secretaries, and today we've heard about Mr. Fong Wai Kong, who is newly appointed as the information coordinator. So I think for these major politically accountable posts, you should also include them in your paper. I hope the CSB will also understand that whenever you create any post, be it permanent or supernumerary, you have to take into account the works, whether the works warrant the creation of such posts. We all see that the frontline staff are complaining that the government is increasing the number of senior posts. They're creating all these directorate posts at the expense of the lower rank and files. The Marine Department has performance is like a mess, but you're not penalizing the director or the assistant director. Instead, you're addition more, creating more posts to assist these incompetent directors. When you talk about housing and land, the Development Bureau and the Housing Department has not been performing very well, and they've been all along asking for the creation of supernumerary posts. But as far as the supply of land and housing units are concerned, they're always lagging behind the expectations of the public. And even Mr. C.Y. Leung is saying that he's not able to deliver, even though the civil servants are working very hard. So does value of money, according to the value of money principle, I think you are now giving these departments more, creating more posts for this department. You seem to be saying that it doesn't matter if they don't perform well, because if they underperform, you'll give them more manpower. The departments which are not performing well, and we are spending more money to create more posts for these departments. So I'd like to ask the CSD, how do you play the role of a gatekeeper? After you've given them the funding for the creation of these permanent or supernumerary posts, I think you have to look at their performances. It shouldn't be the case that if they perform badly, and the longer it takes for them to perform the duties, they will, and then they can't finish on time, then you have to further extend these posts. If they can't finish in 5 years, they want the post to be retained for 7 years. Aren't you punishing the public by doing that? Let me try to answer Dr. Kwok's question. Dr. Kwok referred to the several proposals from the Housing Department, the Marine Department, or the Development Bureau and the Housing Department. I think these three proposals we expect that we will be submitting proposals to the committee for consideration. Amongst these three proposals, whether it's these three proposals and the other proposals, we have adopted the same principle. That is, we will take into consideration the actual workload and see whether or not in certain areas of work which were not included in the original establishment, and whether or not such additional work could be tackled by using existing resources or by streamlining the work processes. If the answer is no, then we have to consider carefully whether or not we need to increase the manpower. But anyway, whenever there is a proposal, we will consider it very cautiously. And the Bureau, other than the proposals from the bureaus and departments, the Resource Department will approve them carefully. The Department and the Policy Bureau, when they submit proposals to LegCo for approval, we need to go to the various panels to discuss such proposals and to discuss the rationale for those proposals. And these rationales will need to be clearly outlined in the documents so the members could have a detailed discussion as to whether or not there is sufficient justification for each and every proposal. Chairman, I don't think he has answered my question. I asked you, what is the mechanism for you to measure whether there is value for money? If a certain department applies for a permanent or supernumerary post, and if the department is not performing well, they can't deliver, And you are now asking the ESC to further extend such posts. You're asking for extension because they're not performing well. Now, originally, you promised that the task would be finished in 3 years. Then they've not done it. They've not delivered on time. Then shouldn't the head of the department, shouldn't he be held responsible? You're saying no. So long as they submit a proposal, the CSB will simply go through the ritual. I'm asking you, my question is about the mechanism. That is the number of accountable, political accountable officers and the respective remuneration. Can you supply us with such additional information? Could you give us such additional figures and an explanation about the mechanism the next time? We certainly would be willing to supply such figures as we'll certainly consider how we can provide those figures to members. Coming back to the question about the mechanism, the whole mechanism would require the department or bureau to submit. We'll have to prove that the work to be undertaken by the newly created post would it's outside of the responsibilities of the existing establishment of the department. So if they don't perform well, so is there a mechanism to deal with it? I think the performance of these various departments are subject to the scrutiny of the general public. When they submit justifications as whether or not they should create a new post, they will need to come back to the and members can then look at the conditions, circumstances of the department and see whether or not there's a need to create new posts to deal with the additional workload. So there is a mechanism both within the government and LegCo. In LegCo, there are various panels to discuss such proposals in detail. Emily Lau, it's your second round. Thank you. Chairman, I agree with Mr. Sin and Dr. Kwok when they asked a question about the politically accountable officers. I think you should really give us all the details about these senior and politically accountable officers. You should give us an overall account and give us the full set of information so that we'll be able to see the whole picture. Madam Chair, in EC1 bracket 9, we're also given the number of judges and judicial officers. At the AJLS panel meeting yesterday, the AJLS panel had a field visit to the courts, and we were received by the Chief Justice. We also have discussions with the other judges. At our panel, we suggested many times that there is a shortage of judges because for some cases, the waiting time is very long. And the Chief Justice understood our concern, and even the general public share the same view, because if a case has to wait for too long for trial, it's not desirable. And if you want to appoint more judges, you need to find quality judges, and also you need to provide additional venues. So I hope the administration will understand the difficulties encountered by the judiciary. You have to help them resolve this problem. I think the overall, the planning, you need to plan for that going forward. Even if we agree to the creation of this additional post, there are still many problems. I hope you will go back and look at this. By the time you are able to, you know, provide the new venues, we're talking about 10 years probably from now. So, but we need to plan. I think we talked to the Chief Justice, and we're all very concerned. We think we need long-term planning. There should be sufficient number of judges and accommodation and office for them. So I hope you will discuss this internally, and also you should take heed of such concerns when you take this up with the judiciary. Okay, we follow on that.
Okay.
All right, if there are no further questions, then we will close our discussion on this item. So let's move on to the next item, EC 2013-14, item 7, or paper 7. And members are invited to recommend to the FC the retention of the following supernumerary posts in the FS or the Financial Services Branch of the Financial Services and the Treasury Bureau for a period of 2 years for the implementation of certain proposals for financial cooperation and strengthening financial regulation and to maintain the stability of the financial system. The FA panel was consulted earlier on this year, and that was agreed. Mr. Lee is here, chairman of the FA panel. So is there anything that you'd like to add? Yes, the FA panel discussed this issue, and my understanding is that members are basically agreeable to this, and they note that during the past period of time, well, the FSTB has already done its job to cope with the situation, and there is a need for the retention of that. We have with us today Ms. Chang and officials who are here. So Ms. Sandra Lam and Ms. Selena Yan, Dr. K.K. Kwok and Mr. Kenneth Leung and Christopher Cheung and Sin Chong Kai and Mr. Wong Teng Kwong. So 5 minutes each. Thank you, Madam Chair. For this particular post, I believe that there is importance to that. But then I'd like to ask about the Tianhai Cooperation Platform. That's para 10, because we believe that for the Tianhai project, in terms of cooperation between Hong Kong and the mainland, well, that will provide tremendous opportunities. Well, we've talked a lot about Tianhai, but then a lot has not been implemented yet. And for those from the financial services sector and also the legal sector, they said that much has been talked about, but then very little has come about. So with the creation of this post, what kind of undertaking can you make to us in terms of the Tianhai project? What will be done? And by extending the post, what kind of homework can you submit to us, whether or not it's to the financial services sector or the related trades? Second, with regard to financial regulatory work, we know from time to time that there would be reports saying that for mainland banks, they will have to implement the Basel Agreement. And also for mainland banks, with regard to regulation of mainland banks, that there have been questions asked about them. And as a result, even Hong Kong's securities market would also suffer as a result of such talk. And there might be volatility. So for Hong Kong listed state banks and also non-government enterprises, when they're listed in Hong Kong, how are they able to meet the local regulatory requirements, and what has been done and what is going to be done in the future? Yes, PAS. Thank you, Mr. Dr. Kwok, for your support. With regard to Tianhai, we have been liaising closely with the Tianhai authorities at different levels. During the past year or so, actually, as far as Tianhai is concerned, we have been maintaining very close contacts with them, and we have actually done that at very high level, even at the CS level. So she has had many contacts with Tianhai authorities, and a lot of work has been done. And when it comes to concrete accomplishments, as Dr. Kwok said, is a place which has gone to the very forefront, and a lot has been done already. And in implementing some of the projects, some details will have to be worked out. And last year, they have announced a number of measures, in particular for financial regulatory work. They've announced that for foreign investors investing in Tianhai, with regard to overseas RMBs, loans, and the management methods, and so on. All right, some of the details have been announced, and for those of us going to invest in investors going to invest in Tianhai, that would be very helpful. So we'll continue to maintain very close liaison with the Tianhai authorities, so that when it comes to the implementation of some of those details, we'll make sure that they are smooth. And in terms of bank loans, they have been doing a remarkable job. And as far as other professions are concerned, we have also been liaising with them. For example, earlier on, they've also announced that for registered tax assessors and how they can work and practice in Qianhai, we have also been liaising with them so that when it comes to actual implementation of the measures, I will be able to deepen our cooperation. On the second part of your question, well, generally speaking, the Honourable Member referred to civil enterprises and also state-owned enterprises coming to get listing in Hong Kong. Well, whether or not they are from a particular sector, whether it's a financial institution or enterprises, when they try to list in Hong Kong, of course, we do welcome that. But at the same time, we also have very stringent requirements that they will have to meet in terms of profit and tax and also the filling of returns and also disclosure of information and so on. We do have very stringent requirements, and we treat everybody on the same footing. And in many areas, they will have to meet objective standards, and the listing committee of the Hong Kong X would also scrutinize such applications. And there have also been new requirements, for example, in terms of the disclosure of certain documents, and starting from the 1st of October, both the Hong Kong X and SFC have also agreed on the enhancement of some of the administrative requirements so that the investing public will understand that these companies are able to face the public, and they are prepared to disclose certain information, and we attach a lot of importance to that and will continue to step up such efforts. Thank you. Mr. Kenneth Leung.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
I'd like the administration to look into it. All right, this post is for 2 years, and you also talk about some international obligations. So can you be more specific about this? What are we referring to, OECD and also G20? Within the next 2 years, what needs to be done? And the second question is, about a month ago, well, the FSTB has established this Financial Services Development Council. They have issued 6 papers on recommendations to be implemented. So which recommendations have you accepted and which will be implemented, and also how you're able to deal with the proposals by the FSC, the Financial Services Council?
Thank you, Mr. Leung, for your question. First of all, on international obligations, by extending the supernumerary post, actually we have already increased the difficulty of the incumbents' duties, because in the past the incumbent used to deal with liaisons with the mainland authorities, but then as you said, we've actually increased the workload for the bureau and the division. Well, after the financial tsunami in 2008, that has given rise to some of the international regulatory initiatives, and some of them are being implemented. And for example, on the OTC derivative market, and also Basel III, these enhanced requirements as far as banks are concerned. So those will be done. And also some of the major projects that are underway include, well, for the purpose of institutions which are important in the financial system, and if they encounter financial or other problems resulting in the possibility that they might fail, then how should that be dealt with? Well, G20 has been looking at the financial tsunami in 2008. Some of the bigger players might fail, and that might also affect not just the local economy or financial system, but also the global system. Well, for the so-called failure by these institutions, the general procedures might no longer apply. That's why we do need to have a specific handling mechanism so that for such big players or financial institutions, if they should fail, then should there be a special mechanism to deal with such cases so that they can continue to operate? That would also include the disposal of certain assets, both good or bad, or whether or not there should be external bailout efforts to help these institutions and so on. So those would have very far-reaching implications. That's why we do need to have dedicated manpower to deal with such work, and therefore we are pretty cautious about this. Therefore, by proposing to extend the time limit for this post, we also hope to take care of that. And of course, internationally, as I just said, we also have colleagues dealing with that, for example, for OTC derivative market. We also have colleagues participating in the work of the Bills Committee. There are other colleagues dealing with that. And for the incumbent of this supernumerary post, his primary task is to deal with the resolution regime. And we hope that with regard to the international regulation framework, that would also be given a lot of attention. And how about the FSC's recommendations? Well, yes, it released six reports, and that has been welcomed by the market, because as we have been doing that already, we'll be talking to different sectors in the market. We try to take on board their views in order to make sure that I will be able to do a better job. In terms of market development, yes, we do have a regulatory framework in place, but then at the same time, we also have to develop our market, because competition is very keen. That's why we'll be looking into the recommendations by the FSC very closely. And of course, on cooperation with the mainland authorities, they have also come up with very specific proposals. We'll be looking into them. Mr. Christopher Cheung. Thank you, Madam Chair. The paper proposes to extend this supernumerary directorate post, who will be responsible for advancing cooperation with the mainland. I support that, because the mainland's financial policies are getting more and more open. A lot of challenges and opportunities have been brought about by these initiatives, and with further financial reforms on the mainland, we have more and more cooperation with the mainland. But then I'm concerned, how come this is not a full-time job? And how come this post also has to take care of discharging our international obligations? And also, with regard to maintaining the soundness of our financial system, is also part of his job. So for this particular official, does he have enough time to take care of these two major areas of work? Because, well, there would be very rapid changes in the financial market. For example, on the mainland, we have the free trade zone, and also they're also going to implement certain initiatives starting from October next year. We also have to set up an asset management center and so on. So for these developments, they are very important to the financial services sector in Hong Kong. We have to get hold of the information as soon as possible. So will the official have enough time to deal with such rapid changes in the market in order to ensure that I will be able to grasp such information in the first instance? So I'd like to know if the post is able to cope with all such work.
Deputy Secretary, thank you. I'd like to thank members for your support and concern. Indeed, the workload is very heavy, and that is a fact. We know that the dissemination of information in a timely manner is very important. I also like to do some publicity here. Say, recently, in the SEPA agreement with the mainland, under SEPA 10, there will be a number of measures which will actually open the door for the financial industry to go into the mainland market. Other than the SEPA agreement, recently we've also put on to our website an FAQ to help the industry understand the situation. So this is this work is undertaken by our colleagues who are responsible for the mainland affairs. So we tried our best to do the best we can, and the reason we are proposing to extend this post is exactly because we want to continue with this area of work. Of course, the panel previously had a discussion as to whether or not this post should be a permanent post. I'm grateful to members for your support. We believe the collaboration with the mainland is permanent, and it's only going to be to become more and more important. As for the manpower arrangements within our bureau, well, I think we're proposing to create this supernumerary post for 2 years, and then going forward, we will further review the workload and workflow of the bureau, and then we'll come up with the appropriate arrangements in due course. The government, the officer in charge of financial policies, were liaising with the mainland. How many officers are there? How many of them are working part-time? Would you consider restructuring the revamping the structure so that they become a supporting unit who will be dedicated to dealing with financial policies in the mainland, so that we'll be able to, get a good grasp of the market development? Retaining this supernumerary post for 2 years, is that enough? Because the development of our economy is close, and the development of the financial market in China is going to be permanent. Why are we only extending this post for 2 years instead of making it a permanent post? Thank you, Chairman. As we've said, we fully agree with members here. Our cooperation in the financial field will be ongoing, and we believe that such collaboration will become more and more important going forward. In terms of deployment of manpower, the incumbent of this proposed post and his team, I think our permanent secretary and our secretary all attach a lot of importance to collaboration with the mainland. Members would note that every year, our secretary and our permanent secretary would participate in meetings with the counterparts in different provinces. So we have dedicated staff to take care of the such work, and we also have involvement by senior officers in our bureau. Regarding whether or not we should make this a permanent post instead, I've already explained just now that the function is permanent, but as to how we make the manpower arrangements within the Bureau, we can certainly review that going forward. As Mr. Mack from the CSB already said, that when we propose any creation of posts, we have to follow the procedure and conduct a detailed review. We need to abide by the principle that we should only create new posts in a prudent manner. We certainly will liaise with our colleagues in the CSB whenever we need to create new posts. So I'll ask the Deputy Chairman to stand in for me for a short while. Mr. Wong Ting Kwong. Thank you, Deputy Chairman. Like Mr. Christopher Jung, I'd like to make the same point. The offshore renminbi product, I think the market for such products is something new in the market, and also we didn't have this type of business before. And this is, we're not talking about sporadic business, it's going to be permanent. And Hong Kong, being an international financial center and a center for the registration of international property rights, I think we should be particularly concerned. So I hope that the government will review the overall structure and see whether we need to allow the panel to have a detailed discussion and then discuss the arrangements. Of course, I support the proposal to create this supernumerary post for 2 years, but I think we should further study this. Although this is only a temporary post, and we know that Shanghai is now creating a free trade zone, and I'm sure this will have some impact on Guangdong and Hong Kong. Earlier, we've also considered whether or not in Guangdong, Hong Kong, and Macau should also create its own free trade zone. The proposal to create this temporary post, having looked at the terms of reference of the incumbent, it does not appear to include work relating to the free trade zones. So, could the Bureau explain whether or not the terms of reference of this incumbent will also cover the setting up of a free trade zone for Guangdong, Macau, and Hong Kong? Thank you, Mr. Wong. As whether or not we should create a permanent post instead, I've already explained that earlier. We certainly reviewed this carefully in collaboration with the CSB. As to whether or not the incumbent concern would also look after the work relating to the creation of a free trade zone, I can say that the answer is affirmative. So whether it's the Shanghai Free Trade Zone and also Free Trade Zone for Guangdong and Hong Kong, I think as the mainland is intensifying the reform of the financial sector, I think the third plenum also reaffirmed this broad direction recently. So in all these, given the creation of these pilot areas for free trade, and as in the past, whenever economic reforms are being introduced, it will mutually benefit the mainland and Hong Kong, and therefore we should grasp this opportunity. We should keep abreast of the development. So overall, the incumbent for this post would also take up the responsibility of building up the platform for collaboration with different provinces and cities in the mainland. So we'll closely follow up on this area of work. Overall speaking, this is a favorable development for Hong Kong. Next, Mr. Sin Chung Kai. Thank you. In Appendix 1 of the enclosure 1 of the paper, that is the terms of reference for the officer. One of the terms of reference is international affairs relating to financial services. In enclosure 2, you have the newly created post which is bracketed. And you say financial affairs, mainland affairs, and you have not mentioned international affairs. So, also, although you're telling us that the incumbent would take care of international affairs, but in fact he won't be doing that. So, 100% of his work will be related to international obligations, and how many percent for his other duties? So, is he really going to look after international affairs or mainland affairs? Actually, the incumbent will also need to take care of international affairs. So it might be some omission here. It's our fault. So I think the incumbent will need to take care of both duties. So how many percent of his duties will be related to international affairs and how many to mainland affairs? I think mainland affairs is now very important at the moment. But another area of work is that we need to set up a resolution regime to deal with the systematically important financial institutions. And if they were to collapse, we need this resolution regime in place. And also the legislative amendment which need to be made will also require a lot of work to be done. I can't give you a figure, but I can say that mainland affairs certainly will take up a major bulk of the duties for this for the incumbent of this post. Mr. Sin Chung Kai, any further questions? No? Mr. Chung Kwok Pan, thank you. According to the paper, it would appear the post is for 2 years, and the incumbent is supposed to help formulate policies. First of all, to build up an effective cross-sector resolution regime, and you say you will propose a bill to let go in 2015. And secondly, the G20 financial regulatory regime. And thirdly, to discuss the long-term financial businesses such as the RMB businesses. You give us the impression that the incumbent will help formulate such policies, and then 2 years later you will then consider whether or not you can delete the post. And the follow-up work after the policies is formulated will then be delegated to organizations like the HKMA. And that's why 2 years would be enough. Secondly, I'd like to follow up on the Deputy Chairman's question, that is the FSC. They've now come up with some recommendations. Later on, if the FSC also come up with some recommendations, are you going to create two more posts to consider how you can implement the recommendation to the FSC? Or should it be like the Deputy Chairman said, we can... we don't need to create additional posts by asking incumbent to take care of those recommendations as well. Thank you. I think we expect. Well, in fact, the collaboration with Mainland in financial and monetary financial matters will further intensify as the Mainland. Continues to open up and reform the financial sector. I don't think we can stay put. Whatever we do today, I think the situation may change tomorrow. I think members will recall that before August 2011, our offshore RMB business would only allow us to open the RMB saving account in Hong Kong. It's rather restrictive. But after August 2011, a series of measures were announced, and our financial collaboration with the Mainland has become a lot broader, including the we're having more and more issuance of the dim sum bonds. The finance ministry is now attempting to issue RMB bonds in Hong Kong, and are the investment products which you may be familiar with, for example, RMB denominated, RQF funds and so on. Or, furthermore, we have a sort of a feedback system. That is, we can use RMB for direct investment in the mainland. Our financial infrastructure, our settlement, I think the Deputy Secretary is not answering my question. She's talking about the broad direction. My question was very specific. There are three areas which the government has mentioned and suggested would need to be resolved. I asked her whether or not they're going to resolve these issues. Deputy Chairman, could you answer Mr. Chung's question in a more precise manner? Well, what I'm saying is that there is a permanent need for this such work. As to whether or not we can, whether or not the work will be concluded and other units can take over such duties in after 2 years. But I think, of course, 2 years later we will review the situation. And secondly, regarding the FSC, the FSC has reflected the market sentiments. And we certainly will look into their recommendations. We will also work with the HKMA and the SFC and the relevant organizations. We certainly will work in tandem with those organizations. As for the overall establishment and the arrangement, we will be prudent. When we look at the duties of all our colleagues in the Bureau, 2 years later we will have a comprehensive review and come up with the proper arrangements.
Anybody who would like to ask in the second round? None? Well, Deputy Secretary, well, Mr. Sin also referred to the chart in Enclosure 2. Will you be supplementing it up with an updated chart? Yes, we can. Well, enclosure 2 just reflects the current situation, but then either is for the future or for the future, we can supply further information. All right, if there are no further questions on this, then I'll put this to the vote. For those in favour of EC 2013-14-7, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. I think the majority of the members present are in favour of this item, and the application is approved. Next, EC 2013-14-8 is a proposal that from the 1st of April 2013 to the 31st of December 2017, there will be a creation of the supernumerary post in the registration and electoral office for the conducting of the 2015 District Council election, 2016 Legislative Council election, 2016 Nominating Committee election, and 2017 Chief Executive election. On the 21st of October, the Constitutional Affairs Panel was consulted, and we have with us Mr. Gordon Leung, Deputy Secretary from the Bureau, and Ms. Helen Chung, and PAS, and also Mr. Lee Pep Hong, Chief Electoral Officer from the REO here. As the Chairman of the CA panel is not here, in accordance with the information prepared by the Secretariat, I'll be setting out the discussion by the panel on the issue. The CA panel, at its meeting held on the 21st of October 2013, discuss the proposal to create a supernumerary post of principal executive officer for a period of 45 months at the REO. Members of the panel did not object to the administration's proposal. The post will be created to deal with the elections to be held in 2015 to 17. And at the meeting, members urged the REO to come up with is planning and preparation for the elections to be held from 2015 to 17 in order to ensure that the elections can be held smoothly. We have Ms. Amberly Lau and Ms. Dr. Kwok Kar Kee. Anyone else? Mr. Poon Siew Ping. All right. 5 minutes each for the first round. First, Dr. K.K. Kwok, Chairman. This is a very important post because what we have four elections to be held in 3 years, and is to be created for a period of 45 months. We have vote planting. This is a very serious problem. As a result of that, many elections have given rise to some court cases, and more importantly, it is also tarnished the reputation of Hong Kong in the democratization process with such vote rigging taking place. And in some cases, some of the voting has been very irregular. For example, they have people having this chop on the palm, and then the elders would know whom to vote, and people would also be coaching the voters as to how they should vote. This is against the spirit of a democracy, and that has also been a blemish to our reputation as a modern city. So there are many concerns whether or not it's vote planting or vote rigging, and also some of the undemocratic or uncivilized way of voting. So how are we able to do something about it? For example, can we crack down on elders being manipulated by others? They would try to put in some signs on the hands, and then they would know who they should be voting for. So how would the officer be able to do a better job in terms of regularizing voting? Mr. Leung, I'll say a few words, and then when necessary, I'll invite Mr. Lee to supplement. On the concern raised by members with regard to vote rigging or planting, on various occasions, we have already given explanation to panel members. Well, starting from the 2011 District Council election, there have been reports by the press that some voters' addresses might not have been accurate, and as a result of that, the administration has already taken a number of actions to double-check such addresses to ensure that the addresses are accurate. For example, we have mounted a massive operation together with the relevant departments. We will cross-check that. For example, the housing department, the housing authority will try to cross-check that information with them. We have also increased the number of random checks. Together with the lands department, we would also be looking at structures or buildings that might have been demolished or that are being demolished. So we have been doing a very detailed work in those areas, and as a result, a large number of voters' registration has to be deleted, and they also have to be re-registered. And as a result, the register has been updated and the accuracy has been greatly enhanced. But then for isolated cases, and of course during those periods, there have also been a lot of complaints for suspected vote rigging and also the provision of false addresses and so on. We have passed that pass those on to the law enforcement agencies, and recently we have also reported to the CAP on the progress. Well, for the number of cases under investigation, investigation has been completed for all these cases, and for enforcement action or prosecution action that has to be taken, basically it's been taken, and in some cases the cases have been heard by the courts, and there have also been some convictions. So if members would like to know the details, we can submit that to members later. With regard to the irregularities in voting, as members are aware, under the current electoral legislation, we do have provisions to prevent such irregularities. But then if there are acts that might not be against the law, that would be permitted. For example, if a political party would like to invite some voters to vote for them, and they would try to lobby those voters, and I'm sure members would understand that that would be permitted. But then at the same time, as the Honourable Member just said, if there is any suspected irregularity which is against the law, then absolutely we do encourage the filing of complaints with the relevant law enforcement agents. We will be following up on each and every case, and they will be dealt with fairly and justly. Well, I'm not entirely happy with this answer. You said that you have to ensure that the work will be done properly. All right, in 2015, we have an upcoming election, and according to your random checks, what are the expected figures? And also, we also have a small unit with people with different surnames being registered at the same address. So what are you going to do about those? So for the details, I'll defer to Mr. Lee from the REO. As the DS just said, well, after the 2011 election, we have carried out a number of cross-checking operations, including those claimed to be residing at the same address. Well, during the last registration cycle, we have cross-checked about 140 or 150,000 voters' particulars, and as a result of that, about 30,000 voters' names have been deleted from the register. And in the next cycle, we will repeat that, and we expect that about 150,000 voters' particulars will be cross-checked. And it depends on the number of new applications that we receive during the new round of registration. We expect that the verification procedures will be extended somewhat, because in 2011, we worked with the Housing Department to conduct a comprehensive cross-checking, and about 1.4 voters' registration information or particulars were cross-checked. We will only do that during a particular election year, because if we do that year after year, that would cause some nuisance to the voters. That's why we expect that in the next cycle, starting from 2015, we'll be doing the same as we did in 2011. And we expect that about half of the voters will have their particulars cross-checked so as to ensure the accuracy of the voter register. All right, I have a follow-up question. You said that you would work with the housing department or the housing authority, but how about those who are not living in public housing estates? How are you going to verify their particulars? In fact, we've been talking to other departments to see if there is any possibility that we can cross-check the information with them. As you might be aware, some departments would also have information about residence addresses and so on, but then this may not be their principal residence, and that might just be for the purpose of communication and so on. So that would depend on the information being held by a particular department, whether or not it's reliable and so on. Well, for Housing Society and Housing Department, the particulars that they hold would be more reliable. Other than that, we have also approached the HAD, which was responsible for the preparation or compilation of the villages' register and so on. And as we just said, with regard to other departments, including the Buildings Department, the R&B Department, we also try to cross-check the information with them so as to ensure the accuracy of the addresses. So we will adopt a multi-pronged approach where necessary. Ms. Emily Lau?
Yes, Chairman. I support this paper. But then, as Dr. Kwok just said, concerning vote rigging, I think we are all very concerned about this. I understand that the administration has done something about it. I hope that you will continue with these efforts, whether it's random checking, because we believe that the problem is still with us. So I hope that the administration can shed more light on that. What are you going to do? Because we have given you more manpower. I understand that the REO might not have enough staff for that. In particular, you're talking about such substantial workload. So I hope that you can do it in a more orderly manner. And of course, on the one hand, we have to encourage those who have yet to register to get registered. And then for those irregularities, you will have to dig them out as far as possible. And then on the handling of complaints, I hope that you'll be able to do a better job in the future. On the day of election and afterwards, there might be many complaints, but then very often you would just turn them aside. So people would think that you have not been dealing with that very fairly. So are you able to deal with that more expeditiously so that people will have the impression that you do have the determination to crack down on such irregularities? And also on the votings or balloting station, you have to rely on people allowing you to use their accommodation. And as a result, many of these have not been barrier-free. So are you able to come up with better methods so that you can have more voting stations so that would be conveniently located instead of changing them from time to time? Because many voters would be very angry about this, because when they go to a particular ballot station, they would be turned away. Three questions on the cross-checking operation. Well, as we said, since 2011, we have taken a series of steps to do that. And we would also be doing that during a non-election year, but then during an election year, we would be stepping up that effort. And also, secondly, on dealing with complaints, as you might have noticed in the past, in terms of the efficiency in dealing with complaints, there is room for improvement. That's why, in terms of training of our staff, we will be stepping up on this. And we will also be stepping up the hotline service the day before the voting, so that where voters have any inquiries and so on, we'll be able to deal with that immediately. And in the light of the experience that we gained last time, we have also reported to the CA panel. Starting from next year, we're going to provide an electronic platform so the voters will be able to find out their registration details online, and to a certain extent that will also help the voters to check their information online so that they do not have to file a complaint if they are not able to find such information online. And also with regard to the ballot station, yes, indeed, there have been some difficulties, and as I've explained to the CA panel meeting, the problem is Hong Kong is a relatively small place. To set up a voting or polling station is not that easy, and we will have to look at the size of the polling station and whether or not they can meet our requirement. And very often, well, from one election to another election, we don't want to change the location of the polling station, because if a voter is used to going to a particular place for voting, and if that changes next time, then that would also make it very inconvenient for him, and therefore we don't want to have substantial changes every time. And if you look at the last election cycle, we've already made a lot of progress in terms of identifying barrier-free polling station. On the last occasion, some 90% of them were already barrier-free. When compared to the last cycle in 2007-08, only 70% of the polling stations were barrier-free. And last time, we already managed to increase that to more than 90%, and we would like to strive for more improvement next time, because this is the Hong Kong government's policy. That is, for newly completed buildings or redeveloped buildings, they have to be equipped with barrier-free access.
However, still many old buildings in Hong Kong, and because they are centrally located, we need to locate suitable premises as polling stations. But in the short term, if you were to drastically increase the number of barrier-free access polling stations, that would be difficult, but we'll try our best. And you said that you would set up a hotline to deal with complaints, but it's not going to be useful, because when people call up and you need people to follow up on the complaint and tell the complainant that you're there with the complaint. You shouldn't just set up the hotline and receive thousands of complaints and you're not able to deal with them. So I think in the at the downstream, you need people to deal with these complaints. If you're talking about polling stations, look at other jurisdictions, they provide many polling stations. Even a small temple could be used as a polling station, because that way you can have a small number of voters per polling station. The objective should be to make it convenient for the voters, rather than having them to go to a remote polling station. So now that you have more manpower resources, could you consider reducing the number of voters each polling station would need to cater to, so that there could be more polling stations and make it more convenient for the voters? I think you should have more clout when you negotiate with people and ask them to agree to use the premises as polling stations. You have to make it convenient for the voters. And I think we've talked about this many times, and I'm really infuriated. You must be able to attract the voters to go and vote. If people complain and you don't deal with the complaint and the polling station are moved to a remote area, please deal with these problems. Any further response? I'd like to make 2 points here. Regarding, we know members concerned about the polling stations. As I said, we will step up our effort. The creation of this supernumerary polls will certainly involve the planning of polling stations. I talk about the hotline on the election day or the day before election. Most of the complaints received was about the voters' details. Very often, some people would call up and say why they're not on the list of electors, and therefore they deny the chance to vote. So after we've stepped up the hotline service, if the public are not very clear about the status on the registrar of voters, they will call up earlier so that they will know which constituency they belong to, so that they can vote accordingly. So these measures are aimed at reducing number of complaints. Of course, you need to entertain the electors and tell them which polling station they go to. I'm talking about the irregularities on the day of election, where you see coaches taking people who wear pins on the lapel and are taken en bloc to the polling station. You may not be able to answer all the questions today, but I think going forward you must come up with a detailed plan as to how you can ensure the election will be open, fair and transparent. Mr. Lee, please deal with these issues. Mr. Poon Siu Pang, thank you. Basically, I agree with the proposal of the paper for the creation of this new post. The paper, according to the paper, within 47 months, there are going to be four elections. You are also proposed to create 74 non-directorate posts. The existing establishment is 138. It will increase to 212. Is it my correct understanding that the 74 non-directorate posts will handle the work up to the 2015 election? So for these four elections, do you think that that would be sufficient number of staff that can cope with these forthcoming elections? Mr. Lee, for the work in the next election cycle, we already have some preliminary plan. For 2014-2015, we propose to increase 74 non-director posts. That will be the first batch. They will work serve until after the 2017 C election, and they will be responsible for planning and managing the election. works. Our preliminary plan is that there will be more than 100 such non-directorate posts created at our office. So it will be in batches. The 74 is only for 2014, 2014, and 2015. But in 2015, we're going to have the district council election, and then in 2016, from September 2016 to March 2017, there will be the C election. So the peak of the work will appear during this period. So most of the additional posts will be created in 2015, 2016. In other words, other than these 74, there will be other additional posts created, except we don't have the specific numbers yet at this stage. That is correct. These 70 posts include, together with the new the posts to be created later on, we are following the usual mechanism for the bidding of resources. So for 2015, 2016, the additional, we will apply for the creation of this additional post following the normal procedure. Do we have any other questions from members for the first round, or do members have any questions for the second round? If members have no further questions, I will now put this item to the vote. Will all those who are in favour of EC 2013-2014-8 please put up your hands. Those against, please put up your hands. We have no members against the proposal. I believe that the majority of members present are in favour of the proposal. The proposal is therefore carried. Next, we move on to the last item. That is item 4, EC 2013-14-9. That is the proposed retention of 3 supernumerary posts of 1 principal government engineer and 2 chief engineers, and extension of the redeployment of 1 chief engineer in the Highways Department up to December 31st, 2017, to continue dedicated staff support at the related directorate level to take forward the Hong Kong Zhuhai Macau Bridge and its related highway infrastructure projects. On the 15th of November this year, the administration consulted the transport panel of this council. Present today, we have Mr. Yao Xing Mo, Ms. Rebecca Poon, Ms. Judy Chung, Mr. Peter Lau, and Mr. Chow Chun Hua. As the chairman of the transfer panel, Mr. Kam Lam, is not a member of this panel, and he's not able to attend today. I will briefly outline the deliberations of the panel. The TA panel on the 15th of November, at its meeting on the 15th of November this year, discussed this proposal. The panel in general support the proposal. Some members asked the administration to consider that after the commissioning of the Hong Kong Zhuhai-Hong Kong Macau Bridge in 2016, whether or not we still need to retain the 3 chief engineer posts to deal with the settlement of the accounts. Other members also believe that, given in view of the link road between Tuen Mun and Chek Lap Kok, will only be completed by the end of 2018. Could the government could therefore consider retaining or extending the post until 2018 instead of 2017. Furthermore, some members asked the administration to provide supplementary information explaining how the 3 authorities, that is Hong Kong, the Mainland, and Macau, have come up with the manpower arrangements in relation to the management of the bridge. The additional information has already been circulated to members. All right, for the first round, we have Mr. Yu Si Wing and Mr. Tung Kok Pan. Shall we say 5 minutes each? Mr. Yu Si Wing. Well, the Zhuhai Macau Bridge will be completed in 2016. People from our industry have gone to Zhuhai. I think the infrastructure has been very well planned. Huangqin, the theme park there, the Ocean World, it's about to be open soon. Whereas in Hong Kong, the planning for, we don't even have an overall plan for Lantau Island. recently the site north of the airport, we're still deliberating how we should use that site. I understand that the planning for the artificial island is not yet completed. We have the border control facility, but we don't have the detailed plan as how you intend to take this forward. So the trade is worried that because of this, it will affect the commissioning of the Hong Kong section of the Zhuhai Macau Hong Kong Bridge. So I'd like to ask the government about the artificial island on the Hong Kong section. Have you completed the tourism planning yet? And if there should be any delay in the project, will the chief engineer have to bear the responsibility? Mr. Yao, thank you. To answer Mr. Yu's two questions, I think the progress of the Zhuhai Macau Hong Kong Bridge is such that we hope it will be completed by the end of 2016. That is, the main bridge will be linked up to the BCF on Hong Kong side and North Lantau. Mr. Yu's concern is about the development of the entire Lantau Island, especially the planning for tourism for that district. A separate department, including the planning departments, are now looking at the development of North Lantau. So they are doing their work, their part of the work. As for the artificial island, we are aiming at for it to be completed in 2016 to tie in with the commissioning of the bridge. On the artificial island, there will be facilities, including retail outlets. Since it is an artificial island built on reclaimed land, and taking into consideration the size of this island, we cannot conduct massive reclamation to accommodate a large amount of tourists or other retail facilities. Our consideration was that the whole purpose is, I think we should not just limit ourselves to the artificial island, we should radiate all the way to Tung Chung and Tuen Mun. From the tourism perspective, we should not just focus our attention on the artificial island. So that's the first point. Secondly, whether or not that there will be any delay, we are still working hard and aiming for completion of the project by the end of 2016. I think you all recall that there have been some hiccups in this project because there was a judicial review as a result of which we need to expedite our work to catch up with the time lost because of the litigation. So we're working hard towards this direction. Mr. Yeo. Well, my question was about the planning of the artificial island. I understand that there's a big car park at this artificial island. There'll be tourist facilities like retail outlets. But for the border control facility, can the government give us a blueprint? In 2016, so how would this artificial island be linked with the bridge? It's only 2 years or more before the completion, and you still yet don't have a blueprint, and you find that very strange. My second question was about responsibility. The Bureau said that we had a judicial review previously, but that if the project cannot be completed by 2016, the chief engineer should bear responsibility. If it's not completed on time and nobody has to bear the responsibility, then why should we hire this engineer? So I don't know what is the administration's requirement of this engineer.
The Secretary, first on the issue of the blueprint, well, on the artificial island, in terms of its traffic network and also the connection or connectivity with the bridge, we do have some plans. As far as the BCF is concerned or the BCP is concerned, we do have plans. But then members' concerns might not be confined to that. You might be concerned that for coach buses and also for public transport, will there be interconnectivity and so on? Well, on this particular issue, we are actually liaising with the Guangdong province and also Zhuhai on how we can put in place some plans. And we will also be consulting the trade to seek their views before things are finalized. We do have some time left for us to deal with that, so members can be rest assured. So we'll be looking at the needs of the trade and we'll be consulting them on what they want. So members can be assured that that will definitely be done. With regard to the duty or responsibility of the engineer, I'll ask the Highways Department to supplement. Yes, thank you. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, members, for your question. Well, as the Director of Highways, if there is anything that is not done properly by the Highways Department, I have an unshakable responsibility. As far as the engineer in charge is concerned, our colleague will also be conducting appraisal report for this particular colleague, and if he has not been doing his job properly, then that would also be reflected in the appraisal report. Of course, we all have to be reasonable when appraising our colleagues, and of course, if there is any slippage of work, we will have to find out why there has been this delay, whether or not is something within the control of the colleague concerned, before we put that in the appraisal report. Next, Mr. Chung Kwok Pan. Thank you, Chairman. My question is similar. Well, for the JR case that has led to the entire project being delayed, and just now the Undersecretary also referred to that, and he said that we would try to catch up and make up for the lost time so that we'll be able to complete on schedule. Well, after all, this is just a wish. And other than controlling the progress, and also I think controlling costs is equally important, because if there is any slippage, then prices will go up, and then in the end, they might have to come back for further funding. So controlling costs and controlling progress are very important. So how confident are you in terms of being able to control the progress and cost? Indeed, because of the litigation, in terms of the workflow and also the construction method and so on, that has led to some changes resulting in the need to catch up. So I'll defer to the Highways Department, which will give you more details as to what has been done to catch up with the lost time. And we believe that what we are doing should be able to tie in with the completion and commissioning date of the major bridge or the main bridge. Yes? Thank you. With regard to the Hong Kong-Macau Dual High Bridge, there are three main projects involved. And when we look at the progress so far, it has been satisfactory. We are moving towards completing everything on schedule in 2016. Well, there are certain milestones. First of all, on the BCP, in terms of the reclamation for the artificial island in 2011, after we sought funding, we immediately started the works. And as the Undersecretary just explained, we have already taken measures. We have adopted more expeditious ways and also materials. We have also increased the use of machinery and manpower to carry out the works. With regard to the land on the artificial island, well, that will be completed in phases next year in order to allow us to build the superstructure facilities. With regard to the detailed design of the superstructure, that has been completed. And for example, for the passenger clearance building and also the cargo clearance building and so on, starting from the middle of this year, we will be tendering out those projects to tie in with the commissioning date of the bridge by the end of 2016. In terms of the cost, we have also been paying attention to the cost for the various projects, in particular for the contracts that have yet to be issued, and also the actual adjustment in quotation and cost. And where necessary, we'll conduct timely review. And so far, the costs have been within budget. And also for the connection with the relevant bridge, we have already started about half of that, including the reclamation and also the construction of the bridge and also the digging of the tunnel. Well, we are moving steadily in those areas. So we are moving towards commissioning the bridge by the end of 2016. According to the present progress, the cost should be within budget. With regard to the connecting of the bridge, as it might be subject to the ground conditions, we'll be monitoring that closely, and when necessary, we'll be conducting timely reviews. And thirdly, it's about Tuen Mun to Chalap Kok's connecting roads. And in June this year, we managed to get the funding from the FC, and there'll be two sections, the southern part and also the northern part. And the northern section has already started works in June this year, and we expect that We will have to tie with the Hong Kong Macau Zhuhai Bridge commissioning, and we expect that by the end of 2016, it should be completed. With regard to the northern section, the contract also started in August, and we have already explained that very clearly to members when we apply for funding. That doesn't have to be completed in time with the Hong Kong Macau Zhuhai Bridge commissioning, and we expect that that could also be completed in 2018. All right, any further questions? Next, Mr. Stephen Ho. Thank you, Chairman. Well, paragraph 11 of the paper, with regard to the technical, environmental protection and so on. So are you able to ensure that the environmental impact assessment on the waters for fishing by the fishermen would also be assessed? Yes, in the course of a design, we would ask the consultant to also look into that. And from time to time, we would also talk to the trade about this. Next, I don't know if it has to do with the JR case. There has been delay, and as a result, the administration, when you engage the contractors and so on for environmental protection works, you might not have done it properly, because as a result, some fishermen would find that in terms of the shark net, you have not been doing it properly, because as a result, the waters there have been very yellowish, and also for some of the shark net, it's very dirty. It's almost blackish. So whether or not they have been illegally disposed of in those areas, and as a result, that might have disturbed the operation of fishermen, because at night they can't see them. Well, during daytime, when they were traveling at normal speed, some fishermen did run into it. So who would be held responsible in case of an accident? Thank you, member. With regard to the shark net, which looks very dirty, well, indeed, there was one occasion in which that happened. That's because the contractors who laid the shark net, because the connection was not done properly, that's why one end got loosened, and after we contacted them, they repair that immediately. In fact, upon closer monitoring, they have not had any further incident. We do have a series of monitoring measures, including water quality and so on. We would also be working with the green groups and also the fishermen groups. And for the data of monitoring, we have been uploading that onto the web, and therefore the public would also be able to find out the water quality nearby the work sites. So far, the situation has been satisfactory. Thank you. Mr. Ho, I'd like to express our concerns about operational safety. That's very important. Next, Mr. Lam Kwok Hong. All right, once again, they brought up the issue of the JL case. I'd like to ask the administration this. If there is a project in which you have not done your job properly, and as a result, people manage to get a JL case, and then the court will have to hear it, who should be held responsible? The DFJ, and then the responsible department, and this is the Highways Department. You said that you had an unshakable responsibility, Mr. Lau. All right, back then, when they applied for judicial review, after looking at the papers, you should have known that you have no case, and therefore you should have told the court that, well, please wait, we can talk it out with the litigants. So you've been encouraging people to go for mediation. All right, the civic party has been very stupid. They did not fight back, or they did not refute. Is it wrong for a civilian or a resident to apply for JL or judicial review? You might as well dismiss the case. All right, the DFJ has looked at the case, and then when they talk to you, they have contacted the Director of Highways and also your subordinates. Have you ever reviewed this JL case? Well, I've been involved in such cases before. I've been using my own money, and I've had meetings with the DFJ, and I would always look at the merits of the case. I think you are actually justifying what you have done. So are civil servants are not responsible for that. So why is it that CY Leung is asking people to go for JR? So you should not have put it that way. All right, it has nothing to do with me. You are not blaming me for that. But then I simply find it too much to swallow. That's why I am trying to refute. All right, well, if they are not happy with that, then of course they will file complaint, and some will also go for judicial reviews. And of course, Mr. Stephen Ho, he is able to file a complaint here. And then if they are not able to do that, then of course they will have to go for a judicial review. And even for the Chinese white dolphins, we still don't know whether or not they will die. Please do not bring that up again, or else we are bound to have an argument, because it's not a sin to file for judicial review. Either it's the official or the council or the administration. All right, they are all involved and they have a part to play, or else why would we have this court case in the first place? Why would you have lost the case in the first place? And why did you have to submit further information? If you had been able to do that in the first instance, then we would not have had this case in the first place. Next, all right, Mr. Andrew Fong has already changed the establishment altogether. I know him. All right, he used to chat with me all the time, so he knows nothing about this job. All right, we are not on that subject. We are not talking about Andrew Fong here. But then if that's the mindset that they have, then how can we comment on this? Because we just have this Andrew Fong taking up the post out of nowhere. All right, you talk about the supernumerary post for the chief engineer and so on. Of course, I cannot say no to this. Why would I say no to it? Then, of course, I'm not going to comment on it. Yes, Chairman, you have banned me from speaking about Andrew Fong. All right, I'll set that aside. But then for these projects, as there have been delays, and therefore you will have to get additional manpower to do it, of course, I would not say no to that. But then there is another issue that I'd like to raise with you. It's about this pose. As Stephen Ho just said, all right, for the shark net, it's a human error, and that did happen once. So my question for you, Mr. Lau, you said that you had an unshakable responsibility. So my question for you is, can you submit a report to us? How come that net was not installed properly? What was the reason? Did you punish anybody for any wrongdoing? Mr. Lau, thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Leung, for your question. With regard to the loosening of the shark net, yes, indeed. On the appraisal of the contractor, we did look into that because once every few months, we would conduct an assessment on the performance of the contractor, and his performance would directly affect whether or not he'll be awarded further contracts in the future, and that has been reflected in his appraisal report. Thank you, Chairman. I'd like to ask a follow-up. Lan Kwa Hong allowed me to ask this first. Well, for the fisherman affected by the incident, is there any way that he can seek compensation? Can he file claims for that? And have you dealt with this case? Director, can you tell us more about this case? Thank you, Chairman. Well, for the time being, I haven't got the information with me. We are not aware of whether or not he has filed for claims for this. But then if he indeed had filed for claims on this, we would deal with that accordingly. Well, please do give us a supplementary paper to tell us more about this. Yes, Lan Kwa Hong, I'll give you I'll allow you to speak in the second round. All right, he has already confirmed what Mr. Stephen Ho said. There was it happened once. So you can identify that fisherman, and then you can tell him that he can file for claims. Next, KK Kwok.
Chairman, I have two questions relating to the main bridge. In the paper, you tell us that in the course of the project, you will liaise with the green groups and look at the situation regarding the China red white dolphin. One of the concerns of the green groups is that the China white dolphin will be affected by the project. What I'd like to know is the so-called liaison. How much of that have you done, and what is the response of the green groups? And secondly, we all know that you are rushing with your project. And what we are most worried about is that in the course of expediting the project, it might adversely affect the safety of the workers. I think there have been fatal accidents happening in the course of the works. Early on in the ERL project, there have been 2 fatalities. As the government tried to catch up with time, how can you ensure that the innocent workers working on this project will not have to jeopardize their health and even lose their lives because of the pressure put on them by the contractors? So what are the figures regarding fatalities and injuries in this project, and how can you ensure that such serious accidents and fatalities will not happen again? Thank you, Chairman. On the question of the China white dolphin, we are always in liaison with the green groups. Once every 3 months, we would meet with them. And I've already said earlier that the quality of the seawater there, I think data regarding water quality there is put on to our website. Not only the green groups will be able to access such information, they would also be able to monitor the progress of our projects and the quality of the work that we've done. On the subject of industry safety, we obviously attach a lot of importance to industry safety. During the early stages of the project, there had been one serious incident, and one including one fatality and a number of people who were injured. In this regard, the Development Bureau has introduced measures to ensure that the contractors will have to follow our safety rules. We also have other measures. For example, if the contractor cannot carry out the preventive measures which are up to our standard, we will not pay that contractor, so we force them to comply in this manner. The law also requires the contractor to implement all the safety measures. If the contractor doesn't perform properly, the Labour Department will prosecute them accordingly. With all these measures in place, I think the contractor will have the incentive to do a good job. Furthermore, we also have on-site monitoring. We have our safety officers monitoring the progress of the whole project. If they see any irregularities, and any breach of the safety plan of the contractor, they will require the works to be suspended until they rectify all the irregularities. Chairman, I'd like to ask the director this. I think other than the major incident which happened on the artificial island, can you confirm that there had not been any other major incidents since? If you don't have a paper for us today, please give it to us later. Secondly, you talk about the Labour Department taking enforcement action there. We all know that the place is very inaccessible. The safety officers or the factory, or under the Factory and Industrial Undertakings Ordinance, the officers, how frequently do the officers go to the sites, including the artificial island, to carry out inspections? Regarding the fatality, there had only been once. Since then, there had not been any further fatalities. To answer your second question, the Labour Department would conduct periodic or random inspections. We don't know when they will go to the site for inspection. I think this arrangement is better because the contractors will be caught off guard, because the Labour Department officers can appear at any time. They wouldn't know when they will be coming to the site. Chairman, of course it's good that they have random inspection, but you don't even know how many times they inspect these sites. It shows that one government department doesn't know what the other department is doing. Ensuring safety of workers is not just the responsibility of the Labor Department. The Highways Department and other departments are also responsible. So if you don't know the details, please ask the Labor Department as to how many irregularities have been detected so far, and give us the details later on. Yes, we'll certainly be able to provide the information later to members. Well, since the construction of the Zhuhai Macau Bridge, how could you give us details regarding the total number of fatalities, minor and major accidents? We do have such figures, and we can certainly supply them to members after the meeting. Next, Mr. Wong Ting Kong. Thank you, Chairman. There's nothing wrong with judicial review in Hong Kong. Everyone is entitled to apply for judicial review. But the JR, in respect of the Zhuhai Macau Bridge project, what is strange is that we have this Madam Zhu applying at the JR. And I think everyone in Hong Kong to ask why. Madam Zhu, was Madam Zhu incited by other people? I think we can see that very clearly on the TV screen. And because of the JR, astronomical sums of money to the tune of billions have been wasted. So the money, I think the money which belongs to the people of Hong Kong have been spent in vain. So this time, an administration will get a good grasp of the progress of the project, and there shouldn't be any further delay. So my question for the Bureau is whether or not going forward, will there be other people who will be again initiating judicial review, thus causing further delays to this project? Chairman, I think both members already said it. The right to apply for a JR is the right of every citizen. If anyone should feel that there any behavior or act on the part of the government which warrants JR so that a remedy could be obtained, the government certainly respect the public's right to exercise such rights. Of course, the eventual decision will be for the judge, and the government also respects the decision of the judge. I also agree with members. Just focusing on the consequence, we respect the public's right to apply for JR, but as far as the consequence is concerned, indeed it has caused a major impact on this project in terms of the time and the money spent and the efforts which have to be repeated. So we don't want a similar incident to happen again in respect of this project. However, I still have to say that if any member of the public feels that there are any parts of this project for which they want to seek judicial review, well, if that happens, we will face it at the time. Subjectively speaking, because we don't want this to happen again. Mr. Wong Ting Kong, I don't have any further questions. I support the Bureau's proposal to create this post so that you can ensure that the project will be on schedule, because this project has a big impact on the economic prospects of Hong Kong. Do we have any other members for the first round? If not, Mr. Seal, you have 3 minutes for the second round. Thank you. Having heard the Secretary's explanation, my understanding is that the tourist facilities on the artificial island would involve other departments, and there are certain issues that you can immediately resolve. But I still hope that the planning for the artificial island, there should be a timetable for the planning of the artificial island, and whether or not it's going to be under the purview of the THB, and if not, when will we get, and if so, when will we get a timetable? Well, within our portfolio, the part relating to the transport infrastructures We have a very clear timetable for the infrastructural parts. If members would like want the specific details, we can certainly provide such information regarding the infrastructures. If members want to ask about the arrange the transport and cross-border transport and traffic arrangements, as I explained before, we don't have a timetable yet because we have to also talk to Macau and the mainland authorities and agree on the detailed arrangements, and then we will need to consult the trade before a final decision is taken. Thirdly, the question about other than transport and tourism, what about the other planning? I think I have to consult with the other departments before I can give you further details. Mr. Yu, since the THB has a chief engineer taking charge of this project, he should coordinate this and give us a timetable. Even linking up the main bridge would require the timetable. And how large a car park would need to be? Is it going to be open-air car park or multi-story car park? You need to ask these basic questions. How can you go ahead with the project otherwise? So I hope the administration will give us a written reply. Chairman, if Mr. Yu's question was about the car park and when it will be completed and how large is it going to be, certainly, well, this is within the area of transport. We certainly provide such information. Well, it's already 10:27, and we still have Mr. Leung Kwok Hong for the last second round. I propose that we extend this meeting by a maximum of 15 minutes. Are there members who are against my suggestion? Okay, Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, you have 3 minutes. Question for Mr. Yao. You said that we don't want to see a JR. Obviously, that's true. But then when people apply for a JR, you are part of the proceeding. You have a duty to provide information. At the beginning, when the judge asked you for an EIA, you did not supply the EIA. You adopted a very arrogant attitude. That's why people want, you lost the case, and the why did you lose the JR? It's because of your arrogance. So why should the responsibility rest with the person who applied for the JR? Because the decision was made by the judge. Secondly, people would apply for JR because of the malpractices by the government, whether it's abuse of power or whatever. There are strict rules governing JR. It's not like me talking like this. So if the JR delayed the project and because of inflation, the cost of, you have overall cost overrun. But what happens if there's a deflation and cost goes down? Would you say that thanks to Leung Kwok Hong, the project was delayed by 3 years, the cost is down by 10%? For the government to behave in this manner, obviously would stir up arguments and controversies in Legco. The right to seek JR and the consequences cannot be confused. If people win a JR, as a result, they can reverse, prevent some irreversible consequences, then you should thank that person. I think want to eat the bread and kick and have it at the same time. The fact that you did not punish the responsible officer last time, I already have been very lenient to you. And then the staff in the DOJ, also, Mr. Leung Kwok Hong, do you have a question? I think you need to be serious. You have to tell us once again whether or not it was the JR. I think because of inflation, there have been cost overrun, and should we blame it on the JR? But then on the other hand, if there is inflation, do we have to thank the person who initiated the JR? Should the government thank that person? Deputy Secretary. Chairman, could you tell us what question Mr. Leung is asking. I've already asked the question. It's been so many years. Mr. Wong Ting Kong is asking, holding the civil party responsible. I'm asking on behalf of the general public as whether any officers have been held accountable. Chairman, I've already said that if any member of the public applies for a JR, the government being a party to the litigation, of course we have a duty to state our case in court. Of course, the event we respected the court's decision in the end, and the repercussions arising from such decisions, including the delays in this project, we are now addressing the consequences now. Chairman, he is wrong. You treat Madam Chu as a thief, and you're the security guard. You let her go into the house and steal some things, and you say the thief is a bad person. I think it's the responsibility of the security guard. Mr. Yao, my question is, as a party to the litigation, does the government have a duty to try to avoid this JR? Have you done anything? Or did you adopt an attitude that you didn't care? If people want to sue the government, you ask them to go ahead. Have you adopted any measures to prevent the JR? Because that JR actually took a long time and wasted a lot of taxpayers' money. So have you done anything? Instead of saying that if you want to seek for JR, go ahead.
Yeah. It's a very good question. In the past, before the formal start of the works, the administration, as far as the Highways Department, has done a lot of work in terms of our choice of sites, and we've also conducted EIA. We have also conducted extensive consultation. We conducted consultation in Tung Chung, and there were different options being proposed on the landing point for the bridge and so on. So we try our best to make sure that we'll be able to meet the legal requirements under the EIA ordinance in order to avoid as far as possible the possibility of people filing for judicial reviews. Despite all that, as we just said, any member of the public would have the right to look at their circumstances and their perspectives in filing for litigation or JR. Yes, we have done a lot of work. In the end, we have been able to proceed on the basis of the present package. Next, Dr. K.K. Kwok. Chairman, with regard to what the Undersecretary just said, I'm really very furious about this, because what they have done is that on this occasion, a member of the public tried to resolve the case through a judicial review. This is really not the best approach. Indeed, as the judge said in his verdict, that the administration has an unshakable responsibility to protect the environment. All right, just now, some members, including the representative from the fishing and agriculture industry, that is Mr. Stephen Ho, he said that the project has had very significant impact on the environment. If they had done a good job in terms of environmental impact assessment, then the judge would not have ruled that the administration lose the case during the first round. Indeed, they have not done it properly. And as we all know, the administration has not done its job properly. Well, in the Hong Kong TV saga, in fact, the administration is now trying to encourage people to file for judicial review. As a member of the public, he or she has no alternative, because she has no way to get the detailed information other than seeking justice from the court. What else could she have done? All right, how can she force you or compel you to submit the information before you did that? When has Hong Kong become a place where the rule by men would prevail? And therefore, the officials can say that he would like to go with his way, and then everybody will have to give way. If we try to trample on our judicial system, then Hong Kong will be very sad, because what we lose is not just a good case, is not just a court case. We'll be losing our governance. So is it that all the officials will sit there and then they'll say that they have already chosen the best package and you should be silent? If that is the case, then Hong Kong is doomed. I've been here waiting for a long while for the Undersecretary to say something about this. I think he has not been fair at all. All right, if you are suggesting that the JL case has resulted in the TH Bureau and also all the policies can be thought through very carefully so that everything will be in line with public interest, that's the very crux of the court case here. All right, you can come out and say that, all right, because of this court case, we have spent more money. Have you told people what the environmental impact has been? And if that is the case, then we do not need to have country parks. How much more do we have to spend? In fact, we're talking about we are talking about trillions of dollars to the developers. Are we saying that with the money there, we should just abandon or scrap all country parks because we have trillions of dollars here? So you will have to be fair to the public. I agree. Once again, I'd like to put this to the Undersecretary. On this occasion, has the administration reflected on itself whether or not and how it can avoid further litigation in the future? Undersecretary, Chairman, for any traffic or transport infrastructure project, one of the important things that we have to do, other than the project itself, we have to make sure that we'll be able to meet public transport needs in terms of protecting the environment. That's also one of the important considerations. That's why, whether or not it's about the spending on any particular project or the design of any project, we try our best to ensure that the nuisance that might be caused by the project to the residents would be minimized. So these are very important principles that we go by in undertaking any project. We've been doing that. And I agree, and I've already explained to Mr. Leung that even before we implemented the project, on the part of the administration, the Highways Department had done a lot of work so that in the design of the project and in terms of the work methods, we try to minimize the impact on the environment. So that's very clear. And also on the money that we spend and also the manpower that we deploy, I think that's of secondary importance. The most important thing is with regard to the implementation of the project and the design of the project, how we can do a good job. So that's our main consideration as to the series of implications and whether or not there might be litigation and so on. All right, while we press ahead with the project, we'll respond as the need arises. But then on this occasion, even though we had the outcome of the litigation, we are still working on schedule. We try our best to catch up with the original schedule. I think the main discussion today, Chairman, is about the manpower establishment. Do we still need the four posts so that there will be continuity and then that would also enable us to catch up with the last time and grounds? I think the question has not been answered. Mr. Wong Teng Kwong, Chairman. Well, Chairman, here we are discussing this. As the Undersecretary, Mr. Yao, said, the focus should be on the extension of the three supernumerary posts in order to speed up the progress of the works. At the time, when it comes to the JL case in question, as a result of the JL case, there has been delay, and we are trying to catch up with the lost time. On the judicial review case, Dr. Kwoka Ki said rule of law is very important. At the time, the EIA report was in line with all the requirements. But then they came up with something that was unrealistic, and as a result, they filed for judicial review. I think what's most ugly about this was they managed to get this elderly woman, Madam Chu. If you had the gut to do it, then why didn't you file for judicial review yourself? Why did you have to get this Madam Chu to file the judicial review on your behalf? So you should not try to cover it up. Well, we have spent public money. We are talking about an astronomical figure, and yet you are boasting or you're blowing your own trumpet. I don't need the Undersecretary to answer your question. Do you think that you have done justice to the public? Mr. Lam Kwok Hong, speaking in the third round, 2 minutes, please. Well, I've been here to ask the administration, and I want it to be accountable, all right? You've said a number of times, even if Madam Chu is a devil, even if she is a thief, all right, she got into the government to steal something. All right, are you suggesting that the administration has not done it wrong at all? I've made it very clear. The DFJ and also the subordinates within the DFJ, and also your officials, all right? The court asks you for a report. It's a very simple report, and you refuse to submit it, and then you lost the case. Is that a fact? Under Secretary, is that a fact? And if you lost the case, then either you commit suicide or you jump into the sea. Buddy, you're blowing your wrong trumpet. You're feeling very well yourself. If you have not done your job properly, how can you put the blame on the others? All right, if you are playing the soccer game against Barcelona, and if you lost the job, and if you lost the game, then you can only blame yourself. You have no one but yourself to blame. All right, you've lost the case. You've been reprimanded by the judge, and taking a step back. Let me put it this way. If that's the way the administration governs, and if it's not subject to the reprimand or censure by this administration, then I would find it laughable. All right, even if Madam Chu is a devil, then, she would be punished by heaven. All right, she would be punished by heaven. There is no way that you can ask her to be held responsible for this. I'm asking the administration to be accountable to us. All right, Undersecretary, how much are you paid? Mr. Leung, please ask your question. Do you need him to answer the question? All right, you should swap your post with Andrew Fong. You should not have been in your post in the first place if you're not able to answer the question. So can you answer the question? Does the administration have to take up any responsibility? You said that you welcome. I welcome that you should admit your mistake. Chairman, in pressing ahead with government works and taking care of the environment, all along we have been doing our duty. We've been trying our best to do it. How come you lost the court case then? Is the judge mad or gone crazy? Has the judge gone crazy? Undersecretary, do you need to supplement? Well, I'd like to clarify this point of fact, because in the end, the Court of Appeal, because you managed to supply further information paper. Please allow him to answer the question. Chairman, you know the case very well, so you should have known what happened. Undersecretary, I've already supplemented. Yes, Stephen Ho, do you have further questions? Well, I don't have to ask any further questions if time does not permit. You have 1 minute. Chairman, today we are here to discuss establishment issue. Just now, I was not challenging the legal basis for the environmental impact assessment report. I was just saying that, the EIA report, as far as I'm concerned, I'm personally not happy with that, in particular with regard to marine parks. But then, administratively, there were problems. That's why we had this shark net case. That was an accident. That's why, for the fishermen friends who had been affected, so how are you going to ensure that that will not happen again? And how are you going to compensate them? I don't want people to escalate that and raise that as an incident at the policy level. Mr. Lau, yes, I understand Mr. Ho's concerns, and in the wake of the incident, we have already taken measures to avoid a repeat of the incident, and we will continue to deal with the situation very seriously. Okay? Any further questions? If not, then I will put this to the vote. For those in favor of our EC 2013-14-9, raise their hands. For those against, please raise their hands. I think the majority of the members present are in favor. The proposal is approved. So members present agree that we should recommend to the FC for approving the three items being put before us today. So all the three items will be placed before the FC. Unless members have objection, then we will ask the FC to approve it without discussion on the three items. Any objection? I think you're in a hurry, so meeting is now adjourned. Thank you.